गुरुर्ब्रह्मा गुरुर्विष्णुः गुरुर्देवो महेश्वरः गुरुस्साक्षात् परं ब्रह्म तस्मै श्रीगुरवे नमः। श्रुतिस्मृतिपुराणानाम् आलयम् करुणालयम् नमामि भगवत्पादशङ्करम् लोकशङ्करम् शङ्करम् शङ्कराचार्यम् केशवम् बादरायणम् सूत्रभाष्यकृतौ वन्दे भगवन्तौ पुनः पुनः। नमामि गौडपादं च शङ्करं श्रीसुरेश्वरं स्वामिनं सच्चिदानन्दमिन्द्रं तं ज्ञानरूपिणे। ओम नारायण नारायण नारायण। सो वी आर डिस्कसिंग दैट विचारावतरणिका। दोज़ हु आर लुकिंग एट द बुक, आई से विचारावतरणिका इज द फर्स्ट व्हाट यू कैन से फर्स्ट चैप्टर लेट अस से। Swamiji has given certain numberings until the end, and he called them khanda in Sanskrit. So no names, 72 let me call as a chapter. 72 points he discussed. So even if the page numbers are different, because of the difference in the edition, there are 3 editions, Sanskrit editions of Sugama and 1 Kannada edition. Whichever book I know you are using, I don't know you are using, whatever book you use, it is in the beginning. As soon as the Mangalacharana is finished, the Vicharavataranika number 1. In that, I think you can say 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. 7th or 8th line, around middle somewhere. So, अतः ब्रह्मज्ञानादेव परम पुरुषार्थ प्राप्तिरिति श्रुति सिद्धत्वात्। अथ अतः इन द सूत्र अथाथो ब्रह्म जिज्ञासा अथ वी हैव एक्सप्लेन्ड। अथ इज आफ्टर वर्ड्स, आफ्टर व्हाट, आफ्टर अक्वायरिंग साधन चतुष्टय क्वालिटीज। सेकंड इज अतः, अतः मीन्स ड्यू टू दिस रीजन, because of this reason, because of what reason, brahma jnanadeva parama purushartha praptihi iti shruti siddhatva. Since shruti is telling us that by knowing brahman alone one attains the moksha. Moksha means freedom, freedom from all kinds of samsara, complete freedom, absolute freedom from samsara takes place only with brahma jnanam. Since this is the reason, therefore we should try to get brahma jnanam, try to gain brahma jnanam, because it is the brahma jnanam that gives the freedom, moksha. Which shruti, shruti means shruti statement, which shruti vakya tells this? Brahmavid brahmaiva bhavati, brahmavid apnoti param. These are the two, there are many more, but just for an example, these two statements are quoted. Brahma vidapnoti param, one who knows Brahman attains the highest. Brahma veda brahmaiva bhavati, one who knows Brahman himself becomes Brahman. Now let us continue. After this brahma jignyasa, athato brahma jignyasa, the third word brahma jignyasa, let us explain. What is brahma jignyasa? Brahmano jignyasa, brahma jignyasa. Jignyasa, desire to know what? Desire to know Brahman. So, what is Brahman? Vakshamana lakshanasya jignyasa. Whose nature we are going to describe in future, but tentatively, just take it that Brahman is the truth. Truth of the universe, truth of everybody, truth of you and me and the whole universe. That truth, jignyasa, desire to know. So jignyasa, when there is a desire, the desire naturally leads a person to observation, examination. So that observation or examination is called vichara. Vichara is inquiry. Atra brahma jnanartham vichara karaniyaha. So the total meaning of the sutra is, in order to gain brahma jnanam, one should do, undertake vichara, one should undertake examination, observation. Okay, from this statement, what are the implications? Tat jnanameva parama purusharta praptim prati hetutvena sochayan. Upanishad also is telling that by knowing Brahman you attain moksha. And the sutra also, keeping that Upanishad Vakya in view, sutra also telling the same thing with logic. See, logically it analyzes, provides the logical explanation to it. What Upanishad reveals as a revelation, sutras provide the logic for it, logical explanation for it. Therefore, tat jnanameva paramapurushartham prati hetutvena. So, jnanam leads to moksha. Because Brahmavid Brahmaiva Bhavati itself is telling. Brahmavid Apnoti Param. Upanishad is telling. Shruti Sutra also is telling the same thing because Brahma Jignyasa. Why do we have to discuss Brahma Vichara? Why do we have to discuss Brahma Vichara? Because Vichara leaves you Jnanam. Okay, then why do we need Jnanam? Because Jnanam leads to moksha. Now, just by Jnanam you get moksha. From this there are two implications arise. This we have to understand. This is the important point here. The very Jnanam takes you to moksha. The very Jnanam helps you to attain moksha. Now, Jnanam means people take Jnanam in two meanings. You take in the worldly sense. One is a paroksha Jnanam. Like as I explained in yesterday's class towards the end in the last minute. There is a swargam. You know that there is a swarga. And how is the swarga? It is described. Just by the description of swarga, you don't come to experience swarga. It is not an experiential knowledge. It is not a direct knowledge. It is an informative knowledge. Theoretical knowledge. It is not theoretical means only informative knowledge. You only imagine, but you don't experience directly swarga now. By the description of swarga, you only get a paroksha jnanam, informative knowledge, not an experience of swarga. Okay. And then by knowing swarga, do you attain swarga? Attain means do you come to experience swarga? No. By knowing swarga, you come to know that there is swarga. So, in order to experience swarga, again two steps are there. You have to perform a sadhana. You have to practice a sadhana. So, in order to attain swarga, it gives a swarga sadhanam. Shastra first tells you that there is a swarga and it is like this. What is swarga? Swarga is a field of happy experience. It is a loka, it is a world where you have a very happy life, where you have a experience of happiness. So, that is a swarga, and here is a sadhanam for swarga. You have a knowledge of a swarga, but you have a knowledge of swarga sadhanam. But even that knowledge of swarga sadhanam doesn't give you swarga experience of swarga. Okay, it doesn't give you swarga anubhava. Then you have to practice it. After practicing the swarga sadhanam, okay, when you practice it, as you are practicing it, do you get instantly swarga anubhava? No. Even while practicing swarga sadhana, you won't get swarga anubhava. That sadhana should be completed. After completing it, it has to take some time to process. Generally, when you apply for something, they say, yes, it is under process. Once the process is complete, the result will be declared. That means the thing will be dispatched to you. Even dispatching means it started from there, it has to reach us. Similarly, when knowing the swarga, knowing the nature of swarga, and knowing the sadhana and practicing it, then even practicing is not enough, even completing the swarga sadhanam is not enough. So the result of the swarga is experience of swarga has to come to you. For that certain time and certain conditions are required. With this human body you can't experience swarga. There are very few people, our Puranas say. Do you I think it is a secondary issue, it is a deviation, but I tell you, since the time has come, context has come. Can people with human body go to Swarga? It's not possible with everybody. A very few people with an extraordinary punyam can go to heaven. These days we don't find them. Two reasons are there. We are not accepting it that human being with a human body can go to Swarga. Of course, you can go there and stay for a short while and come back. So, the human body going to Swarga, first thing is, these days, the faith in Shastra, all this is coming down because of too much of materialistic view. Partly these European religions, and also partly our Bahirmukha Drishti, Nastika Drishti. Because of the Nastika Drishti we are. But I tell you, I met one person, and he's a sannyasi, his uncle, eldest uncle. He was living in Vrindavan. I wanted to see, but just at that time alone, I've been postponing, once I will go, and he just passed away. He was a very quiet old man, 90 years old man at that time. He had such a capacity. He could go to Pitruloka and talk to your ancestors, your Pitrus, and come back. Not only that, if you want, he will take you with him. Can you imagine? You have to lie down and he'll give you some instruction, some meditation like, some hypnotism like, and he will take you there. And you will see your ancestors, father, mother, if they are not in this loka, if they are in that loka, they will appear to you. You can talk to them. He will also go and talk to them and come back. So, this is a very peculiar thing. Therefore, certain things are happening even now, here and there, very rarely. But Hindus are such dumb fellows. There are many events occurring in the society which prove our Pauranika and our Shastra. Why Pauranika? Even the Veda, Purana, even our Yoga Shastras. People having occult powers, supernormal powers, people going to other worlds, seeing the distant objects, seeing gods. All these things we should have done in a modern way, like a research. Like modern research we do, go and, in fact, we should establish an institution or some ashramas or somebody, keep the equipments and people, well-trained people. Whenever you get an information that somebody has some power, go, watch him, request him and allow him to test. And you'll put in the proper conditions and ask him to perform whatever he has got this, ask him to demonstrate. And whatever powers he has got, he demonstrates. People going out of the body, going in distance, seeing all those things, experiences were there in those days. They were not very common, because only few yogic people having certain powers alone would have. Everybody would not have. Even in those days, any days it was a rare alone. But wherever few rare events, those things were recorded by our Puranas and Shastras and Veda. So even now those events are occurring. But we are educated in a Western system. Therefore, first thing is we disbelieve. See, what is the scientific outlook? Scientific outlook should make us open-minded. Any new phenomena, if we come to hear, if we come to know, if we come to see any new, peculiar, strange phenomenon, what are we supposed to do if we are scientists? If we have scientific mind, first don't dismiss it, study it. If you can't study, depute other persons, ask them to study. What we have learnt from science is, anything in India is nonsense, dismiss it. Anything Europeans lie, anything European superstition, believe it. This is called so-called science. In fact, a scientific mind is a person. A scientific mind is that mind which listens to any new phenomenon, studies it. Patiently studies it, open-minded studies it. After finding that it is not true, then you dismiss it. But before you study it, never dismiss it. But we have been taught to disbelieve and discard anything which our modern science doesn't accept. Okay. This is not openness, this is not scientific mind, this is a blind belief, this is a superstition, This is a closed mind, not scientific mind. This is not openness, but this is superstition. Why should we dismiss any new phenomenon? So human life becomes deficient for want of this knowledge. See, any new phenomenon we must study and understand. More we know about life, more we become open-minded. More we come to know the different levels of world. Otherwise, what we know is this limited physical world. We dismiss the supernormal world, beyond the physical world. Our Shastra says physical, non-physical and spiritual. Adi Bhautika, Adi Daivika, Adhyatmika. Our Shastra says world means three. Adi Bhautika, that is a physical world. Adi Daivika, that is an occult world. Occult, other lokas, all the supernormal, supernatural. Then the third is Sakshat Chaitanya Atma Adhyatmika. People are so confused that they talk ethics is Adhyatmika. They talk Dharma is Adhyatmika. They talk little Puja, they call it Adhyatmika. Puja is Adi Daivika. Puja, Ishta Devata, all that is Paraloka is Adi Daivika. Paraloka is not Adhyatmika. Okay, common man's thinking. Why I am criticizing? Because medical terms, much more scientific terms have become the words of a common man now. Common man's mouth, you can see them very highly technical terms of science. All technical terms of science, medical words common man is using. Why can't we distinguish Adi Bhautika, Adi Daivika, Adhyatmika? Highly educated people do not know the difference between Adi Daivika, Adhyatmika, Adi Bhautika. That means they are becoming illiterates day by day about simple things about Hindu religion and spirituality. Whereas we know much more technical details, medical details, the equipments, the medicines, the chemicals, what does that chloroquine contain, everything we know. Much more technical details we know about medical science or certain other technical knowledge also. Regarding what you call cell phone, computer language, how many technical terms we come to know, the cell phone, internet, computer, so many things we know. But when it comes to Adi Bhautika, Adi Daivika, Adhyatmika, simple common sense. In India, illiterates would know, those who listen to Purana, that we don't know. Because we are closed-minded. Not that we are growing in terms of scientific mind, we are becoming closed-minded. By being exposed to the Western science, we are becoming closed-minded. We are becoming more superstitious. They say Hinduism is a religion. All religions are superstitious. Okay, this is the one we got a logic. Therefore, religion is superstitious. So, Hinduism is also superstition. Leave it. Let us develop scientifically. In the name of science, what is going on is only a blindness, closeness. Okay, let us say. So, whatever phenomenon we see, that we should study. If had we studied, even now it is not too late. Open institution. In ashramas, if government doesn't permit anyway, if privately not possible, like ashramas, where our yajnas, our pujas, Adi Daivika research, we have to call it Adi Daivika research. Adi Bhautika, our modern science does it. Adhyatmika, Vedanta does it. Okay. Adhyatmika research, Vedanta does it. Research means Tattva Vichara is Vedanta. Vedanta sadhana is research, that's all. Vedanta sadhana is Adhyatmika. Practicing Vedanta sadhana, living, shravana, manana, nididhyasana, all this is Vedanta. Tattva Vichara is Vedanta. Adhyatmika. Adi Bhautika, we do it. But even in Adi Bhautika, many things we are not studying. Adi Daivika, we are telling. Adi Daivika Research Center. All occult powers, all unusual, supernormal phenomena, Paraloka, Punarjanma, remembering past janmas. Whatever there is an event, instantly go there. Keep the proper equipment, proper conditions. You should have a little modern scientific mind. I mean scientific method. Mind means scientific method. And also our traditional knowledge, little bit of our Yoga Shastra, our Puranas, and little bit of our, what you say, Adi Daivika. Then put them the questions. Get the proper answers. Then analyze all the data and put together and you will get a clear picture of Adi Daivika Prapancha. Those research institutes are closing down. Our ashramas were teaching both Adi Daivika and Adhyatmika. Because Adi Bhautika you need not teach, Laukika schools will teach you. Adi Bhautika also little bit they were teaching. What is that? Ayurveda, लौकिक नीति. लौकिक नीति शास्त्र इज सिविक्स. सिविक्स एंड सोशियोलॉजी इज कॉल्ड अवर नीति शास्त्र. लाइक पंचतंत्र, वी हैव गॉट लॉट ऑफ महाभारत आदि बुक्स, दे टीच यू लौकिक नीति शास्त्र. एंड देन अवर आयुर्वेद टॉक्स ऑफ द फिजिकल वर्ल्ड, इजंट इट? आयुर्वेद टॉक्स ऑफ द फिजिकल वर्ल्ड एंड अवर नीति शास्त्र टॉक्स ऑफ द सोशल लाइफ, एथिक्स, सोशल लाइफ एथिक्स, एंड देन सिविक्स, सिविक्स नॉलेज, एंड राजनीति ऑल्सो टॉक्स ऑफ दैट. देन कमिंग टू द आदिदैविका, सो इन दोज डेज दैट वॉज ऑल्सो टॉट लिटिल बिट, बट मोर वर आश्रम्स, नॉर्मल गुरुकुलास टॉक ऑफ दीज थिंग्स, बट दिस ऑल्सो आदिदैविका एंड आध्यात्मिका. Now ashrams have becoming adidaivika. They have, they themselves, some of the Vedantins themselves make fun of these, all this paraloka punarjanma, all this thing, all andhavishwasa days. Super normal, when you talk of anything super normal powers, oh, all that is arthavada. Arthavada means that is a figurative poetic way of expressing. Vedantins started talking like Jiddu Krishnamurti. Even Jiddu Krishnamurti didn't say, but anyway, that's how some people take it. So you dismiss all this adidaivika, paraloka punarjanma, all that is nonsense. Superstition. More and more Vedantins are becoming like that. I see the modern English medium Vedantins, most of them dismiss all these things. They talk of only Brahma, that's all. Modern sannyasins, English medium sannyasins behave like this. Paraloka, punarjanma, mandira darshana, nadi snana. Nadi snana means, oh, clean water you enjoy. Hey, it is not a picnic that you enjoy. It is a shraddha, bhakti, nadi snana is a punya. It is an adidaivika karma. It is a punya karma. They don't have an idea of punya at all. Everything is Brahman. So they have become a semi-nasticas in the name of Vedanta. Okay, so adidaivika world is ignored. Yogic powers, tantric powers, phenomena, the world and the bhutas. Bhutas are there, devatas are there. Ishta ide, ishta devata darshana, yogic powers, all this is an adidaivika prapancha. Okay, so this sadhana, our shastra says, and then you have to practice it and then you get them. Okay, so we leave them. Just I told you already, it's a deviation, the little bit people has to know. So adidaivika is a different, that people should know little bit. In Vedanta, when you talk that adibhautika, adidaivika, all put together is within Brahma, that is a Vedantic vision, that's a different level. Okay, so when you practice swarga sadhana, with the human body, some people can go to swargam. So as I told you, there was one person in Vrindavan, aged man, is a Telugu man from Guntur. And younger brother's son is a sannyasi, even now is alive in Rishikesh. And he would say, his uncle could go to Pitruloka and talk to the people and come back. If you still have a doubt, if any event happened in your life, when that person, supposing your grandfather passed away, if some grandfather or father or mother or anybody passed away, some event happened in your life which we don't know, he will go and talk to them and come and tell you that, you see, this event happened in your life and your grandfather told me. He will be so shocked, you see, he will go and find out, and he directly talked and tell you. So, those vidyas, those upasanas were existing, we have lost. Even now there are few, but we just ignore them. Because our so-called scientific mind has made us closed fellows. Anyway, so swarga also people could go in those days. Therefore, when Mahabharata says that Indra has gone there, or sometimes Indra comes and talks to you, these are not superstition. They are very much true. Only thing is, they are adhidaivika phenomena. They can come and appear in human form. Indra, Varuna, Agni, Adi, Devatas can appear in human form and talk to you. Even now they appear. Even now they appear to you, very few people. Even in those days, very few people. So, we have to study that. Study means in a modern way, modern scientific way you study them. Our traditional way is there always anyway, Purana and yogic way is there. It is always there. So you can learn. Okay, anyway. So, swarga, only except those few situations you can go and see, come back. If you have an extraordinary yogic power, you can go to swarga and see the Indra and those people and come back. But if you want to stay for a long time in swarga to enjoy as an inhabitant of swarga, as a guest of swarga, you can go as a human being. As a human being, you could go visit and come back. Of course, if you have that little yogic power or some such thing. Or other way is, if you want to be an inhabitant of Swarga, you have to put an end to this human body. You have to put an end to this human body and then assume the Devata Loka Sharira, because there is a Swarga Yogya Sharira will be there. A Sharira, a body suited to the Swarga, you have to assume, and with that body you can stay in the Swarga as long as your Punya permits you. Okay, now coming back to our topic. Because when I say simply Punya, all the things you may say superstition, therefore I had to give you little this explanation, this background. So the Punya you acquire with the mind, because body is only an instrument. Body is only an instrument, it is Antakkarana. The Jiva who is identified with Antakkarana, he performs them. And whatever he performs with a proper Shraddha, Bhakti, feeling and attitude with your mind and heart, that generates a Punya. Punya means what? A capacity in your mind. See, it generates a capacity in your mind, and because of that, when that Punya starts affecting, what happens? Your mind assumes the Devata Sharira. Your mind assumes the Devata Sharira. Mind also is transported, transformed, transported to. Your mind is transformed into Devata Sharira. One aspect assumes the Devata Sharira, another aspect transports your Sukshma Sharira. When this body is dropped, it helps you to assume a Devata Sharira, Swarga Sharira, Swarga Yogya Sharira, and also takes you to Swarga. And it keeps you remain there as long as that effect of Punya works in two ways. One is it retains you in the Swarga Loka. And also that Swarga Yogya Sharira also you will retain. Swarga Yogya Sharira and Swarga Loka. You enjoy there, you become happy. So there is a difference between world human Loka, Manusha Loka and the Swarga Loka. So that Swarga Loka, the special enjoyments, special happiness, higher degree of happiness, you can enjoy there. But once that Punya is exhausted, your body dissolves. That Swarga Yogya body melts away. And then that place also will be closer to you, as if you are waking up from the world, waking up from your dream world. You will be just leaving that world and assume another body and come to another loka. Isn't it? So there is an entry loka from this Manusha loka in order to go to higher lokas or lower loka. There is an entry point to common loka. That's called, we call them this Pitru loka. This Pitruloka, this is the common loka. From there people will be deviating to Swarga loka, Brahma loka, Vaikuntha, or other lokas, downward lokas, or even if you get next birth, there is a common, that is the Yama loka. That's where you will be, what you call, different ways you are divided. Okay, all this is Adidaivika world is very interesting. People should know, but anyway, our topic is Vedanta, but we discuss little bit of Adidaivika also. People should know, Hindus are totally kept away. When Hindus are kept away from the, why Hindus are misbehaving? They are not defending it. Why they are talking all religions are same? Because even in Adidaivika, there is a lot of difference. The other religions, the so-called, this desert religion and then this Jerusalem religions, they talk of Adidaivika, no Adhyatmika. Even in Adidaivika, they talk of superficial up to Pitruloka. There is no higher lokas for them. There are no many lokas. There are no higher lokas. It is a very superficial. That shows that too it is a copied status. So it's a very super. But we have got a much better, much meaningful, much convincing. But you see, Hindus are kept from their Hinduism in the name of secularism. The secularism is a tool to keep Hindus ignorant of their own religion. And Hindus have so much absorbed this anti-Hindu secularism. If you want to teach them Hinduism, they are the first ones to say, this is all superstition. Why are you teaching us? India should advance. India should develop. You see how Europe, America is developing. We also must develop. If you want to develop, first thing is secularism. Means what? Set aside Hinduism, then India will develop. Only reason, set aside Hinduism, India will instantly develop. See. This is the education we got. Therefore, I had to tell you a little bit about Adidaivika also. Okay, coming to the point. So, here what we are talking is Jnanena Moksha. So, Jnanena Moksha, just by knowing you attain the Moksha. by knowing alone how can you attain? Here when you want to attain Swarga, you want to attain Vaikuntha or anything, mere knowledge will not take you to Swarga. By knowing Swarga, you don't go to Swarga. You don't come to experience Swarga. Knowing is a paroksha jnanam. It is an indirect, it is a distant knowledge, an informative knowledge. It is a theoretical knowledge. It won't give you experience of Swarga. You have to do. So after knowing this informative knowledge is not a knowledge. Generally we say knowledge is always a direct knowledge. Knowledge is direct, experience is knowledge. Experiential knowledge means direct, isn't it? When you describe Himalayas from here, you imagine this is an indirect knowledge, paroksha jnana. When you go and witness Himalayas, that is a direct knowledge. Okay, pratyaksha jnana. Similarly, the pratyaksha jnanam, direct experience alone is knowledge. So this knowledge of Brahman will give you instant moksha. So here in attaining Swarga, knowledge will not give you. You have to practice it in order to attain Swarga. We have to, after gaining knowledge, that knowledge is only a too remote knowledge. Remote means is a theoretical knowledge, imaginary knowledge, informative knowledge. You have to practice it. After practicing also, you have to drop the body and assume the Swarga Yogya Sharira, a body suited to Swarga, and then once you reach Swarga, then you experience starts. By knowing Swarga and the experience of Swarga, what a distance, see. In between, how many steps are there? Therefore, that knowledge doesn't give you Swarga directly. With knowledge, so many steps are there to be able to experience Swarga. Similarly, Upasana. You have a knowledge of Vaikuntha or Vishnu or Kailasa or Shiva, so on. Devi, all these people. By knowing the nature of Vishnu is only a theoretical knowledge, is a distant knowledge, a remote knowledge. You have to practice meditation. Then you have to undergo a lot of transformation within your life, your mind and sense organs, thinking, your attitude, your feelings. Feelings have to be purified, thought is purified, personality has to be integrated, totally purified. You start seeing the whole world as a Paramatma, devotion, surrender, so many things are required. Then the whole transformation in a life, then life, you may have a little darshan of your Ishta Devata, Vishnu, Krishna, Shiva, Rama, you may have. Even after darshana, it only shows that you have achieved halfway. You have achieved halfway that after the death of the body, you are more likely to go to Vaikuntha or Kailasa. Now, whatever vision you had of your Vishnu, Rama, Krishna, so whatever sadhana you have been doing it, maintain it. Now, you got the vision, but you have to maintain it. See, two things are there. When you are doing Vaikuntha sadhana or Kailasa sadhana, so this Vaikuntha, Kailasa, let me tell you one small point here. Vaikuntha, Kailasa, Devi, all these are Pauranic names for one Brahmaloka. Upanishad uses the one word and one name. That is Brahmaloka and Brahma. Saguna Brahma and Brahmaloka, that's all. Those things in Pauranic way, they started calling Vishnu as a Vaikuntha Loka, Shiva as Kailasa, Devi as Manidvipa. Then in Rama Sampradaya, Rama is a Saketa Loka. Then Iskan, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu Sampradaya, Krishna is a Goloka. So these are all different way of talking about the same. So Upanishad talks of Brahma Loka and Saguna Brahma, that's all. Therefore, hereafter let me use this. Whenever I say Brahma Loka, you take, now each time I don't say, once in a while I may say, so just to remind you. So Vaikuntha, Kailasa, all these are Saguna Lokas, Saguna Brahma Lokas, in different versions, means different way of explaining that Lokas. So, instead of each time taking all these four or five names, I just say Brahma Loka, which Upanishad has been using. Okay, so the Brahma Loka. So, to go to Brahma Loka, you have to, doing some Punya Karma is not enough, as it is enough in order to go to Swarga. In order to go to Swarga, doing some Punya is enough to take you to Swarga. But here, to go to Brahma Loka, you require a total transformation of a personality. And here, as a result of your continuous meditation, and then your Ishta Devata, and also discipline goes with it. The purity, the discipline, the Shraddha, Bhakti, Sadhana, Bhajana, Kirtana, Yogic Sadhana, whatever you do, all that will give you a vision of your Ishta Devata. But this vision once you get your vision of Ishta Devata, darshan of Ishta Devata, sakshatkara of your Ishta Devata, you will be fit for Brahmaloka. But that Brahmaloka won't come now because you are already passing through the human janma. It has to be exhausted. Human janma, this human body, human punya, whatever your earlier karma, has to be exhausted. Once the human life ends, then you will be taken to Brahmaloka. So therefore, once you have a vision, after getting the vision, you have to do the maintaining sadhana. First thing is, you become fit for going to Brahmaloka, you have a darshan of your Ishta Devata. Saguna Brahma darshana. But one, you can't say that once I had a darshana, later I need not do any sadhana. No, you have to do lifelong sadhana. You have to maintain it lifelong. Until the body drops off, then after the body drops off, then you will be carried to through all these lokas. As I told you, there is one common loka, Yamaloka, everybody has to pass through. Then Swarga also you have to pass through. Then you will be taken to the highest Brahmaloka. Then as you are going to enter Brahmaloka, then you will assume a Brahmaloka body. A body suited to Brahmaloka. From there, I think you assume the body suited to Brahmaloka right here alone. At the Yamaloka stage alone you will be given. From there you will be taken there and you will go to Brahmaloka. So even here, I explained this because Vedantins know, those who have not studied Vedanta in much, for them I have explained it. Why I explained it? To show the contrast with Jnana. Nirguna Brahma Jnana, in order to show you the contrast, I am explaining. With karma Swargaloka, with Upasana, you go to Brahmaloka. But in both these things, knowledge has not given you. Knowledge has not given you direct experience of Swarga, nor the direct experience of Brahmaloka. Okay, knowledge has not given you. Knowledge is still preliminary stage, only informative knowledge. As there is, after the knowledge, you have to perform the karma or upasana. Then even after performing karma, upasana is not enough. You have to leave this body. You have to put an end to this human life. Then you assume that body and reach that loka, you will be transported to that loka, then the experience of Brahmaloka or Swargaloka begins. See, knowing about Brahmaloka and experience of Brahmaloka, what a distance in between, how many steps you have to go through. Then knowing Swargaloka and also reaching Swargaloka, how many steps in between you have. So, unlike that, Brahma Veda Brahma Iva Bhavati. I explained all these things partly to understand Hinduism. Secondly, within Hinduism there is an higher one. There is another one which is a Nirguna Brahma Jnanam. There, what happens? So Jnanam alone gives you experience. As you know, you are that. Ha, beautiful. This is the highest stage. So, Brahma Veda, Brahma Iva Bhavati, to contrast it, I explained this thing. See, unless you say, compare contrast, you won't understand it all. That's why I am very fond of comparing contrasting. Some people don't like, but I do a lot of comparison. Because this is how I also did manana in my student days. I have been doing a lot of manana. Then I got these things. So, the same thing I have been explaining to others. I have been a lot of comparison contrast. So, now they say Brahma Veda Brahma Iva Bhavati. Then as the Upanishad told that Brahma Vidapnoti Param, by knowing Brahman you attain the Parama Purusharta Moksha. One who knows the Brahman becomes the Brahman. Two statements. Knowing the Brahman, you are Brahman. Knowing the Brahman, you attain Moksha. So these two statements. Keeping these two, not only these two and many, many more Upanishadic statements as a basis, Sutrakara Badarayana says, Brahma Jignyasa. That means Brahma Jignyasa gives you moksha. Therefore, Brahma Jignyasa should be done. Inquiry into the Atman, Atma Vichara or Atma Examination, Observation should be done. Here the question, by the very knowledge, when you get knowledge, get moksha. This is the statement of the Upanishads and the Sutrakara. Up to this, Sutrakara. So, in keeping with the Upanishadic mantras, Sutrakara explained from this love. Ika Bhashakara comes. Upanishadic mantra and Sutrakara, taking these two as a basis, two more implications Shankaracharya is deriving. In those implications, Adhyasa Bhashya comes. Now you understand why I am going, where am I going, all these things. See, Swamiji's Smarana, all this I am getting, I am only expanding, explaining what Swamiji taught. You see the Swamiji's Smarana. Sugama is a, I say, as Adhyasa Bhashya is a great Grantha, similarly Sugama is also is an unparalleled Grantha. Na bhuto na bhavishyati, adbhuta vada manana. I think nobody can do for another 1,000 years. Another 1,000 years such a book will not come. Should not come. I don't make a rule like that. But thing is, such a rarest person who can do such a manana only will come in 1,000 years. So we have seen him recently. Itself is our saubhagya that such a person may not come for another 1,000 years. Therefore, the jnanam gives you moksha, jnanam eva, see I read here, that jnanam eva parama purushartha praptim prati hetutvena suchayan. In the middle of the paragraph you can see, ityuktya, atra, beginning of the sentence, atra brahma jnanartham vicharah karaniyaha, ityuktya, what are the implications, that jnanam eva parama purushartha praptim prati hetuhu, jnanam alone is a hetu for parama purushartha. That means the very knowing you are liberated. The very knowing you are liberated means what? Just by knowing, how can you get the experience? Isn't it strange? In all other cases, in going to Swarga or anywhere, even the Laukik things also, just by knowing you come to experience it. After knowing, in order to experience it, in between there are so many steps. There is a karma, transformation, effort and the effect of the effort, transformation, reaching and come to experience. How many things in between? But here, the very knowing, you become free. Brahma Veda Brahma Iva Bhavati, Tat Jnanam Eva Parama Purushartha is final Purushartha. Absolute Purushartha is moksha. So the very knowing is moksha. So the knowledge is the means. Means means just by knowing, you attain the moksha. Just by knowing when you attain the moksha, two implications Swamiji derives. Swamiji means Shankara derived but did not say. When he wrote Adhyasa Bhashya, this is what he derived it. Swamiji is explaining that missing link from the Sutra to Adhyasa Bhashya. He just wrote Adhyasa Bhashya and went ahead. Then one is surprised, where does Adhyasa Bhashya come from? Some people say, oh, it is not there in Sutra like Western Indologists, it is not there in the Sutra, it is not there in the Upanishads. So Adhyasa word itself is not there, how can there be Adhyasa? Then where does it come from? He is imported from Buddhism. See, how they go. How they go. Incapable of understanding and start relating to Buddhism. So this is a ridiculous thing. So Swamiji is trying to show how Adhyasa Bhashya is derived from the Sutra and the Bhashya, Sutra and the Upanishadic mantras. So we don't have to go to Buddhism, we don't have to go elsewhere, in Western Indologist also. That's why yesterday I discussed all Western Indologists. Probably you must have felt, what is this, why is he going somewhere else? Because this is where it is. If you look at these things, you won't understand Adhyasa Bhashya and Upanishadic mantra and Sutra, there seem to be no connection. See, in this implication, now just now I am going to discuss, in these implications, two implications which Shankara has derived, that one implication he put here as an Adhyasa Bhashya. Okay. Let us see now. How he derived? What is that implication? How he derived? So, Jnanena Mokshaha. Jnana means here. Just by knowing can you attain? Just by knowing you attain. We know generally knowledge itself doesn't give you experience of anything in life. You know after knowing you have to do many more things to come to experience it. So there are two things in life, two kinds of knowledges. One is a remote knowledge, another is knowledge gives you instant experience. Now the question comes, how can knowledge gives you, as you know you come to experience it? How? That is possible only If the thing is already in your anubhava, or in the worldly example, let us say, if a thing is right in front of you are already seeing it, but you are not aware, you are not able to identify it. You are seeing it, you are looking at it, but you are not paying attention, you are not identifying it. See, just just knowing is different from identifying it. Identifying means specifically paying attention. You are just barely watching it, but you are not paying specific attention to it. Just a worldly example. Right in front of you, you just look at it, but you don't know who is who. You are seeing them. Somebody comes and tells you, he is so and so. Oh, yes, I see, but I did not know. You are seeing, but not identifying. Something like that. Just a given example. Similarly here, if it is already in your experience, just by knowing it, you know that, oh, this is what I am already this. So the very knowing gives you experience. The very knowing gives you moksha experience, only that moksha is you. If the moksha is myself, therefore first implication is swatma bhuta brahma praptireva parama purushartha. The very knowing makes you that. What you know, you become that. Whatever you come to know, you know something, you become that. That means before you know, it doesn't mean that. Before you know, you are not that. After knowing, you become that. It doesn't mean that. See, just by knowing, how can you become that? See, you know anything. You see a tree. Do you become a tree? You see a wall. Do you become a wall? You see another person. You see a donkey. Do you become donkey? You see an elephant. You don't become an elephant. You come to know it. But here, as you know, as you intuit, you are that. Therefore, knowing is becoming. Brahma Veda Brahma Iva Bhavati. Here, becoming is not really transforming and becoming. The very knowing becomes that experience means you are already that. Only thing is, you thought you were not. There is only a misunderstanding is intercepting. You are already Brahma, but there is a interception. There is a misunderstanding that you are not Brahma, although you are Brahma. Although you are Brahma, you are not aware of it. So if that being Brahma and not recognizing it, if there is a misunderstanding that misunderstanding correction is called Jnanam. Correcting that misunderstanding is called Jnanam. That misunderstanding is set aside, disproven. You disprove the misunderstanding, then you know that you are already there. Oh, you are already Brahma. By knowing, you come to discover you are already Brahma. Therefore, Atma Bhuta, this is the first implication. By knowing, you attain. How can you attain that? Just by mere knowing, you can attain if you are already that. This is the first implication. If you are already that, then only just by knowing, you can attain. Now, we got two things I tell you. Knowledge is a two type of knowledge. One knowledge instantly gives you, the very knowing gives you experience. Another knowledge is, you know it indirectly, remotely, and later you come to experience it. So here, all non-Advaitins in the Upanishads took only one kind of knowledge. After knowing, see, according to Advaitins, there are two kinds of knowledges taught in Upanishads. One is, as you know, you instantly know it. That means it is already experience. Already you are in the experience. Already you are in the Brahma experience. You come to discover, you feel that you are already there. This is one knowledge. This we called Vastu Tantram Jnanam. Jnanam means this knowledge directly puts you in the experience. Second knowledge is, you know it remotely, and later by doing something you come to experience. So this first knowledge, Shankara talks about it. But all non-Advaitins who have criticized Shankara, who came after Shankaracharya, who criticized Shankara Bhashya, they never discussed this point. When they want to refute Shankaracharya, Shankara told there are two types of knowledges very clearly. One knowledge is a remote knowledge. The very knowing doesn't give you experience, but there is another knowledge. The right now you see. You are already in that experience. You know it. You are already that. This knowledge, Vastu Tantram Jnanam, Shankara discussed. They never touched it. They never refuted it. They never criticized it. As if it is non-existing, they set aside and went away and started criticizing Shankara in their own way. So there are few things which what Shankara touched, they also never touched. That means in refuting Shankara, the essential points of Shankara they never touched. They took certain secondary arguments and started writing books, pages and pages, piles and piles they wrote, but this point they never touched. That means Shankara was not attempted even to refute Shankara sufficiently. Therefore, Shankara stands proven as right because they couldn't do anything. So, one is jnanam. This vastutantram jnanam, when you, as you know, you directly know, come to know it, directly you faced an anubhava, directly you come to experience it. This kind of knowledge, they are not even aware, shall I tell you? In all their literature, in all their vyakhyanas, prasthanatraya vyakhyanas, you never find mentioned that there is a vastutantram jnanam. All knowledges they talk of is only a paroksha jnanam. It's a very surprising, very, very surprising. But Shankaras throughout talks of vastutantram jnanam. Strange that they never looked at Shankara Bhashya. They never looked at Shankara Bhashya. And they say that we have refuted Shankara and we have improved, we developed over Shankara. Oh, all post-Shankarites, acharyas, some of them are opposite camp means those who differ from Shankara, start a different school of philosophy. Even they have also not refuted this point. Even now, if you want, you talk to them and read their books. Wherever in the Upanishads, see, this much we can say. In the Upanishads, wherever the word jnanam, veda, vittu, wherever the word veda, jnanam, these words come. Wherever the word jnanam comes, in some context it means upasana, in another context it means jnanam, vastutantram jnanam. Vastutantram jnanam means direct knowledge of experience. So, they have taken, non-Advaitins have taken uniformly in all Upanishads, wherever jnanam means upasana only. Brahma vidapnoti param, that means what? You first listen to the description of Brahman, later you meditate, then you will have a darshana of him. Saguna Brahma darshana you will have. First you listen, then meditate, then darshana. So, there the knowledge directly doesn't give you experience of it. After knowledge, you have to do something in the mind, upasana or karma. So the result, the darshana is a result of upasana and karma. It is not a result of jnanam. But Shankara is talking of another jnanam, which is the very knowing. No upasana, no karma. Just as you know, you are it. That means it is already your experience. Huh. This is the most important thing. Okay. So, this vastutantram jnanam, in Upanishads there are two. In upasana context, that upasana type of, the same word jnanam means upasana. The same word jnanam means vastutantram jnanam in the context of nirguna brahman. Nirguna means our own anubhava. Nirguna brahma means doesn't mean outside. Nirguna brahma is your atma. Your own atma. So, when you are discovering, when you are understanding your own atma as brahman, their knowledge alone is enough. When you are discovering brahman something, you as a knower and you are trying to have an anubhava of him, that is a saguna. Saguna means something other than you. You are trying to experience it. Their knowing alone is not enough. Doing something is required. Therefore, in the Upanishads, there are the word jnanam means two. So, two types of jnanam is discussed. This, they have never touched it. You see them? Ramanuja Bhashyam I referred. And then Madhva Sampradaya Bhashyam also I referred. They say jnanam. Whenever comes Ramanuja circle, Ramanuja commentary, Ramanuja, and their sampradaya, I am talking of other acharyas also. Wherever jnanam comes, they say meditation. The dwelling on it. Dwelling, what you hear the description of him, your mind dwells on it for a long time. Keep on imagining, creative imagination. Creative imagining, your mind starts assuming that form and having a darshan. They talk of that kind of a jnanam. Upasana, they call, wherever jnanam comes, they define it as upasana. Okay, that's one thing. So, Brahma vidapnoti param, with means they explain one thing. Second point here, Brahma veda brahma iva bhavati. In these things they say, when you know Brahman, you become Brahman. That means you stand as a Brahman. Very knowing, just by merely knowing you become Brahman, means you are already Brahman. Now, what they say, ब्रह्मवेद ब्रह्मैव भवति ओपनली मुंडक श्रुति इज टेलिंग सो इन माध्व संप्रदाय और द्वैत संप्रदाय व्हाट दे से इज व्हेन यू नो ब्रह्मन यू बिकम ब्रह्मन दे यूज द वर्ड ब्रह्म इन टू सेंस सयोह वै परमं ब्रह्मवेद ब्रह्मैव भवति परमं ब्रह्म इज परमात्मा ब्रह्म अंद्रे जीवा दे टेक दिस वे सी परमं ब्रह्म इज ईश्वर ब्रह्म भवति अंद्रे उत्कृष्ट जीवो भवति उत्तम सात्विक जीवो भवति हीग माडिदरु ब्रह्म की सात्विक जीव एंद अर्थ माडिदरु सो इट लुक्स फार फेच्ड इजंट इट इफ यू लुक एट द उपनिषदिक मंत्र मुंडक कॉन्टेक्स्ट हिंदे मुंदे प्रीवियस लेटर देसे सयोह वै परमं ब्रह्मवेद ब्रह्मैव भवति वन हू नोस द ब्रह्म ही बिकम्स ब्रह्मन बिकॉज द वेरी नोइंग नो नथिंग एल्स टू डू बट दे टुक टू थिंग्स बाय नोइंग मीन्स द वेरी नेचर ऑफ नोइंग एंड अटेनिंग ब्रह्म टू थिंग्स दे हैव इंटरप्रिटेड डिफरेंटली वन इज द वेरी नेचर ऑफ नोइंग नेचर ऑफ ज्ञान देर नेचर ऑफ ज्ञान ज्ञान इज नॉट वस्तुतंत्र बट उपासना देन द अटेनिंग ब्रह्म मीन्स नॉट डिस्कवरिंग द सेम ब्रह्मन एज माई सेल्फ बट becoming brahma means becoming a utkrushta jeeva see these are not found in the wordings of the mantra you have to extract a meaning by which is not in the wordings you don't find this meaning in the words you have to just bring out lot squeeze the words and then take out far fetched meaning anyway so just for your information I told you here sutrakara is just going by the upanishadic mantras And it also it is in keeping with anubhava. Same thing Bhashyakara took it. Okay. So Brahma Veda Brahma Iva Bhavati, as you know, you stand it. Second thing is, okay. Just by knowing alone, second point, two implications I told. Just by knowing you become Brahma means you are unless you are already Brahma. Just by knowing is not possible. Just by knowledge alone is talking is not talking upasana type of knowledge. Is talking. वस्तु तंत्र ज्ञान डायरेक्ट नॉलेज सो बाय नोइंग अलोन यू अटेन ब्रह्म मीन्स यू आर ऑलरेडी ब्रह्म यू ओनली डोंट नो दैट मीन्स व्हाट इज इंटरसेप्टिंग यू आर नॉट नोइंग यू आर रॉन्गली नोइंग अलोन इज इंटरसेप्टिंग सो व्हाट नॉलेज कैन डू नॉलेज कैन ओनली करेक्ट दैट मिसअंडरस्टैंडिंग एंड यू अटेन इट देयरफॉर यू आर ऑलरेडी ब्रह्म इज अकॉर्डिंग टू उपनिषद्स वन इम्प्लीकेशन That means knowing means you are already knowing yourself as Brahma. Second point is when you are already Brahma, what is intercepting is misunderstanding. That misunderstanding alone needs to be corrected. So this is the implication, second implication in the Upanishadic mantra as well as the sutra. This second implication that the interception is only a misunderstanding. That misunderstanding Shankaracharya understood and put it explained as an adhyasa. Okay, now you got it. Where did you get that adhyasa? He found that if by knowing alone I come to know myself, then why I did not know? Because there was a misunderstanding. That because of misunderstanding, being Brahma I did not know. Therefore, knowing alone was required. Just knowledge alone was required. Because why knowledge alone can do? Because knowledge can remove what knowledge can do? Can knowledge create something? Can knowledge transform something? Knowledge can only correct the misunderstanding. So that misunderstanding which knowledge can correct, that misunderstanding he is bringing out Shankara writing in the form of adhyasa. Okay. So this adhyasa bhashya Shankara drafted according to keeping the Upanishadic mantra and sutra as a basis and also based upon anubhava. So this paragraph we have to discuss a little more point about the same two implications I have to discuss a little more. Once I discuss it, I think in the next class, we will proceed with Adhyasa Bhashya. Okay, Adhyasa explanation. Then what is that misunderstanding? What is Adhyasa? Here directly your Anubhava we will be discussing. We will discuss there. Okay, but tomorrow also a little bit, 5 to 10 minutes is there. Om Shanti 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 Harihi Om Shri Guru Bhyo Namaha Harihi Om Tat Sat. Today there is no power. Power means is giving a trouble, lot of high fluctuations. So there is no power. Probably, let us hope tomorrow will come. Om.